key word of the lecture today is laziness. I mean a special kind of lazy. Everybody knows the famous scene when Archimedes discovered his principle lying in a bathtub. Or the anecdote about Newton sitting under the tree when he was bonked on the head by an apple, which led to realizing the existence of gravity. And there is the urban legend about Sir Alexander Fleming as a careless lab technician letting mold to grow in one of his plates that eventually resulted in the invention of penicillin. When I mentioned laziness, I do not mean the ordinary connotation. I use the word for impact, to have attention. Usually I refer to myself as lazy as well. These great scientists and researchers were anything but lazy. They worked tirelessly, usually day and night, but the casual observer can think that they were lazy based on these stories for people to be able to identify with the exceptional personalities. It is much more easy to accept their existence if they were a little bit like ourselves, at least. During the first lesson with a new student, I usually warn them about the dangers of practicing. And I would like to quote from one of Hungary's most well-known poets, Attila József's beautiful poem, I Can't Breathe. Come, freedom, you give birth to an order for me. Educate with nice words, but let it play to your handsome, serious son. Because it is quite common that if I work too hard and relentlessly with a musical piece, I lose perspective. It is very important to recognize that the purpose of practicing is not to make us unable to repeat the notes without mistakes, but to ascend above technical difficulties and to achieve a certain flexibility that makes us mindful of the altering variables around the performance. Without these mistakes of this kind of laziness, we would not be able to achieve anything significant. Why mentioning all this? What does it have to do with the sonatas of Joseph Haydn? When I first met this music, I was 25 years old, and Hungary was at the beginning of the transition from communism to democracy. We called it the change of system. I was full of hope and optimism like nearly everybody else around me. Since then, 30 years has passed, and the changes did not go exactly as I rather naively expected. In 1990, I was a freshly graduated with distinction young cellist, without a job, but full of confidence about the future. I just started to discover my real abilities, and the future seemed to be bright. We had a violin and cello duo, and we had many, many concerts all over the country for cheap money and sparse audiences. We were constantly trying to broaden our meager repertoire, which was very thin at first, but we managed to make about 200 pieces by the end of our cooperation. Duos for violin and cello, perhaps it is not even a real genre, and consists mostly of 20th century pieces like Ravel or Kodály. So we had to make a lot of new discoveries, commissioning new pieces and do our own transcriptions. Without the internet, those days were more difficult, but also more rewarding at the same time. Today, if you cannot find something on the imslp.org or on other sites, that music is simply non-existing. Back then, I spent a lot of time in music libraries all over Hungary and sometimes abroad in Austria and Germany as well. I had some interesting discoveries, six duos from Pleyel and Arbesberger, and a lot of fake duos from the 20th century as well. There were quite a few, to be honest, surprisingly a lot of duos for violin and viola. So it seemed to be obvious that besides the easier duos for two violins, like Telemann or Bartók, this was the main direction of our path. We played Mozart, Michael Haydn, and this is the way how I came across for the first time with the six sonatas for violin and viola by Joseph Haydn in a Vienna library. I just wanted to start the exhausting work of transcription when I discovered a small caption in the viola part of these duos. It said that there is a copy of these very sonatas for violin and cello in a certain Bologna library. So we ordered copies from the cello version from Bologna, and after some months, we got the copies of the music from an original period published version of the sonatas. I became aware only much later that this edition was in fact the first real edition of the sonatas, printed by Bayeux, Paris, 1775. This will be significant a bit later. And this was the time when I actually became suspicious, because as everybody knows, the opus numbers in Haydn's works are not really trustworthy, except for the string quartets. But still, the pieces I have already known had an opus number of 96, the viola version. These sonatas for the cello or the bass had a much smaller number, namely opus 23. So it was the first time when I began to suspect that something is not fully right. I have already known that in Haydn's own list of works, he mentioned the sonatas as written for violin and viola, but this version, the one with bass, was published, even admitted, by the editor of the prestigious Handley edition for violin and viola, much later than the one with bass accompaniment. What is more, in the preface of this Urtext edition, there is a sentence mentioning Haydn's Entwurf catalog, the list of his works by Haydn's own hand. Here, Andreas Friesenhagen writes as it follows: he entered them into his Entwurf catalog under the heading of Solo per il violino, solo for violin, to which he later added six violin solos mit Begleitung einer Viola, six violin solos with viola accompaniment. Even Mr. Friesenhagen could not determine exactly when this amendment was added. How much later did Haydn change his title to the viola resolve? It may have happened only after the publishing of the sonatas for violin and viola. It would make sense to assume that Haydn made this compliment when the music appeared as a new work and a new opus number. The viola version became quite popular, having more editions than the first variant. But there were a lot of handwritten copies circulating from the sonatas at their time of their birth. My handwritten copies from the Hungarian Library of Keszthely are, of course, for violin and bass. This copy is even listed in the Handley edition as source. But I do not want to deny that there are many others for violin and viola. But there are period versions for even two violins from the very same pieces, and there is no proof whether it was made by the publisher or the composer himself, just to make the confusion even bigger. The fact is that the pieces were written around 1770 and published first for violin and bass in 1775 in Paris, as I have already mentioned. The six sonatas are a real opus, as consisting of six works in similar construction, in related keys, as it is expected at the time. They are violin sonatas, or violin solos, where the second instrument's role is limited. It could be a cello part of a Haydn piano trio. It means that, from one point of view, it is not really important what the second instrument is: viola, cello, double bass, a violone, or a second violin, or even a keyboard instrument capable of playing the hidden chords between the lines. The only proof that the original set is for violin and viola is the work list of Haydn, where he signed them like that. But as we have seen it, it happened only later than the first entry. I have several hypotheses why would Haydn do that, but of course without any hard evidence. For me, the most plausible explanation is that he could sell the set as a new and original opus, and so being able to get more fee from the publisher or a commissioner. And there seems to be an understanding that the Entwurf catalog is not perfect either. For the composer, it was not the most important thing to be precise about his works. The priority was to be full, to include all the works he wrote. I think it is more than understandable. For a composer, the most important is the music he writes. And we must not forget, it was a time when all the works Haydn writes are becoming automatically the property of his employer, until he gets permission to sell some. Perhaps I have to say a few words about this employer and the circumstances by the time of the sonatas. In 1770, Haydn is at his prime. He is 38 years old, not a child prodigy by any means, never was, by the way. He is totally different from Mozart in this regard, too. He is not yet considered to be one of the greatest composers of all time, but he is famous enough to know and knows his craft well enough. He has already written about 40 symphonies, two dozens of string quartets, and hundreds of other music, piano sonatas, masses, baritone works, etc., etc. This would be a whole earth for any composer. His current employer is his force. He was quasi-sold two times, when the former employer died or went bankrupt, and was even inherited once. He is not a free artist by today's standards, but in some ways he has opportunities far exceeding most of his peers and later colleagues as well. because chance helped him to become the Kapellmeister, musical director, of Nikolaus Esterházy in Hungary. Hungary was at the time 70 years after the liberation from the Turkish occupation and decades after a major freedom fight war, which left her with limited independence under the rule of the Habsburg Empire. The Esterházy family had a close alliance with the Habsburgs. This is how they emerged as one of the wealthiest clans after the turbulent years. As I have already mentioned, Haydn was lucky to be in the service of Nikolaus Esterházy because this lord had a nickname, Majestic, or in Hungarian, Pompa kedvelő Miklós. His father, Prince Paul Anton, who engaged Haydn for the service of the Esterházy family, was also very musical, playing several instruments, but his son became more of a cultural collector. Prince Nikolaus extended the orchestra, 24 members, one of the biggest permanent orchestra of the time. He built an opera house in the garden of his palace, the Hungarian Versailles, learned to play the baritone. This is why we have hundreds of works from Haydn for baritone, even though a lot is lost. He was interested in other art forms as well, but his main field of interest was primarily music. This is why he spent most of his time away from the court intricacies of the Habsburg Vienna, which is only 60 kilometers from the Esterházy estate. Haydn complained sometimes to be isolated from the outside world, but exactly these circumstances helped him to become really independent and original, to be the father of the Vienna classic style and the founder of genres determining music's development ever since, like the symphony or the string quartet. He had some of the best instrument players in his orchestra, like Luigi Tomasini, the principal violinist of the orchestra, and Anton Kraft, the principal cellist. I would not be surprised to learn that they played the sonatas sometimes in Esterházy for a small party or house concert. Haydn could experiment freely with his ensemble. He was even encouraged to do so, and he was, after some initial difficulties, greatly in the favor of the prince. I think everybody knows the famous story of the Farewell Symphony, when the musicians asked Haydn to remind the master about their well-deserved holiday, and Haydn was cheeky enough to write this impertinence or slightly offending musical prank to earn this, and he was even rewarded for it. By the way, this symphony was also written in 1772. But let's turn back to the sonatas. I think it is safe to say that they were not intended primarily for the concert stage. This is mostly intimate music and meant for the enjoyment of both players, real chamber music. I have to remind myself that this was an era without a lot of things we consider obvious, like television, newspapers, movies, or the internet. In the 18th century, there were none of it, especially not on the brink of Europe in a provincial, wounded country. There was the church for education and the pub for fun. Music making was one of the sources of fun for the wealthier families to be able to endure long, cold winter nights confined to the house, so music was perhaps a little more appreciated then. Publishers were in demand for new pieces all the time to be able to indulge the audience's appetite for this kind of claim. Exactly this is why I believe that the sonatas originally were written for solo violin with accompaniment that could be nearly any instrument. The first printed edition, as we have already established, was undoubtedly for violin and bass. This bass thing, I am a little sad to confess, was not necessarily the cello. Most of it can be played on double bass or a bassoon, but if we are looking at the very few chords of the part, yes, then it is obvious that this can be played only by a cello. The bass part is in a sense the same like the viola part, or the viola part is the same as the bass part for that matter, and even if this was not transcribed by Haydn himself, being very simple to put it one octave lower, I cannot imagine that this task was done without Haydn's explicit request or permission to the copyist or the printer. Can you imagine that Haydn sent the sonatas for violin and viola to Bayeux, and the latter would change it to violin and bass arbitrarily? Haydn had to be aware of this, and had to be paid for this as Opus 23. Later, when he published it under a different opus number for violin and viola, and for some reason he had the urge to amend the Entwurf catalogue, of course, he was remembering the latest version. This is when I have to quote again today's motto about laziness, if I dare to accuse such a great musician of ever being lazy. I do not want and do not dare to question the leading role of the viola version, but I would like to claim an equal place for the cello version. This claim is not based only on the historic data. The viola version is perfect. How would anyone question that? But what a difference. With the cello, the sonatas gain a sound that is closer to a string quartet sound. And to reinforce this, please listen to the beginning of the string quartet in G major, opus 76, number 1. And the beginning of the sonata in C major. For me, this correspondence is still striking. Or the slow movement's mood in the E-flat major sonata put into the otherworldly A-flat major key. For me, it is very close to the character of the beautiful slow movement of the string quartet in G major, opus 77, number 1. This movement is in E flat. The structure of the sonatas is pretty similar. All six consist of three movements. The first is moderate or moderately fast, the second is the slow movement, and the third is a minuetto with variations. To compose for two stringed instruments is a hard task even for a great composer. Even Ravel complained about it when writing the great sonata for violin and cello. Why would it be any easier for Haydn? But this orchestration is a further argument for me in favor of the violin and cello origin. If you listen to a recording of a small part with viola and afterwards the same excerpt with cello, thank you. difference is really dramatic. Just an octave lower and still the sound is fuller, more profound. While the viola version is excellent for chamber music in its original sense, the cello version is fine even for a concert podium. The style is classic. This is the time of great transition from Baroque to classic. The celebrated composer of the era is Bach, but not Johann Sebastian. His heritage is already in a Cinderella oblivion for nearly 100 years, and he is dead for only a little more than 10 years. The light is on his sons, Johann Christian, who was Mr. Bach for Mozart, and Carl Philipp Emanuel Bach, role model for Haydn. Also, this is the time of the Sturm und Drang, Storm and Stress, which is a proto-romantic movement in the German literature and music for the free expression of extreme emotions. We can see some beautiful examples, especially in the four minor key slow movements of the sonatas, how this universal feeling was distilled in Haydn's art, being far away from the cultural centers of Europe. And there is still the undeniable impact of the Baroque music. Haydn uses the counterpoint with a certain ease throughout all his creative life. There are small fugatos in several places within the sonatas, like in the development of the C major's first movement. I have a special relationship with this music for more than 30 years. I hope I didn't become too obsessed by them, and I am still able to hold some distance, but of course I have some positive bias towards the sonatas. There are scholars and musical scientists who did convince me about the primacy of the violin and viola version. I still cherish some doubt because of the timeline of the printed versions and some subjective feelings about the style. But the most important thing is that it would be a waste to let the cello version being forgotten. If there was a call, a request for it some 300 years ago, perhaps it is worth to bring it back and use it besides the viola version. This music deserves to be played and listened to in every conceivable way. I was not really lucky by this adventure so far. At the beginning of the 90s, it seems to be much more promising. We made a hasty recording of the sonatas for the Hungaroton, the Hungarian recording company. I even had a living contract about the printed version with cello for Edizio Musica Budapest. The world premiere recordings were totally resonanceless. Nobody was interested in, but of course, I never was a good promoter of my own work. But the score had an even worse fate. After a lot of work, research, and years of waiting, the publishing company went bankrupt. When I wanted to get my manuscript back, they confessed to losing it. I was simply too tired and lazy to complain. There were some years of grieving over the loss, and afterwards I became friendly with the owner of a new, small, private publisher, and I started over the whole thing. Again, years went on. They were never really satisfied with the score. I rewrote it about 5 times, but in vain. The enthusiasm of the beginning was lost forever, but at least I managed to keep the manuscript. This is what we will use today for the very first performance of the 6 sonatas by Haydn for violin and bass in Australia in this form. And I would like to use the help of the Griffith University Queensland Conservatorium to be finally able to print this quasi-urtext edition and to spread it for happy music making and listening. And now we will play 3 of these sonatas with the amazing Courtenay Cleary. We will play the C major sonata, then the B flat major sonata, and last but not least, the A major sonata. Thank you, and I hope you will enjoy it.
Thank you. Thank you.